Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here at the Reformed Church of Stout. Few announcements for you. First of all, consistory meeting this Tuesday night, elders at 6:45 and full consistory at 7:00. And Sandy Delbert has lunch, okay? So, although he's a baker, so he might be able to put something together. All right. Also a reminder that the 5th of February, we'll be having a CPR class that Brent's going to lead for the high school kids. I think we'll just stay in the fellowship hall and be part of that. We won't have Heidelberg Catechism. I know that bums you guys out, but also remember the student care packages for our college students. Get them a gift card or give Tammy some cash or whatever, and we'll send them a love gift. Pleasant Valley's having their soup supper tomorrow night at the Grundy Community Center from 4:30 to 7:00. So if you don't want to cook, you can go down there and have some chili or some oysters or both maybe. And then next week, just want to highlight this. Tammy's going to be taking pictures of the Sunday school classes, also the adults during fellowship time, and also the choir. And choir members, you're asked to be here by 9:00, put on your robes, and come up here to the sanctuary. And she is going to take some pictures of that as well. And I think that's all the announcements I've got. Does anybody have anything else? Yeah. Okay, so Tammy will have some cards that we can sign, and we'll send those along with the love gifts with our encouragement and just our best wishes for them as they go through their college education days. All right, thank you. Anything else? If not, let's stand and let's greet each other this morning and then remain standing for our call to worship and opening prayer. Many of you know I'm not a snow lover, okay? I do not care for snow. But I have to admit, Thursday morning, having everything white, covering up that dirty old snow, it looked nice. It really did. It looked nice. And so that spawned me to think of these verses from Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you and you only have I sinned, and I have done what is evil in your sight, so that it proved right when you speak and justified it when you judge me. Cleanse me with hyssop, O God, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let's pray. Father, indeed, the beauty of your nature was displayed again this week with the layer of that white snow. That snow that didn't blow around and just covered everything that was dirty. Lord, may you wipe us clean. May you wash us clean. May we too be whiter than snow in the eyes of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray this morning. Amen. Our opening hymn, A Child of the King, number 316. May be seated. Kids, come on up. Come on, Trey, I need your help. No, really, I do. I've got something I'm thinking about, and I can't think what we called it, so you're going to help me, okay? Think you can do that? Okay. But you're not going to sit by the girls. All right, So remember when we used to have kids' time and we played the game where somebody went and hid and then everybody went after him? You remember that? What did we call that? We didn't call it hide and seek. What did we call it?
Sardines.
Sardines. Yeah. Okay. No wonder I didn't remember that. Sardines. So the idea is somebody went and hid and then everybody went and looked. And if you found that person, you crawled in that hiding space with them, thus sardines, I think, right? Okay. So you guys know what hide and seek is, right? How much fun would it be if we played hide and seek this morning? And I'd sit here and I'd say, okay, we're going to play hide and seek. You guys go hide. And I'd just sit here and watch. Would that be fun? Would it be easy to hide if I watched where you go? No. Okay. That's why we cover our eyes and count to whatever or do whatever, right? So it makes it fun so we don't know exactly where somebody went. But guess what? God sees everything that we do, every place that we go, okay? And I'm going to talk to the adults about how that can be encouraging and how that can be a bit unsettling or a bit scary, okay? But I want you to remember that God's always watching you, and he cares about you, and he will help you, okay? So never forget that, and remember that God doesn't play hide and seek. That's just for us guys, okay? All right, let's pray. God, I just thank you that you indeed watch over us. I pray that you would especially watch over these young ones, that you would bless them, yes, but that you would also protect them. Lord, we just thank you for their love and their enjoyment that they bring to us, their energy. We just praise you for all of that, and we pray again that you will help them in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Whoops. Better. Oh. Sardines. I'll try to remember. All right, at this time we'll have our special music. It's given to us by Jill and Randy this morning. Some of us can barely carry a tune in a bucket, and then there are those with that kind of talent. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come humbly before you, for you indeed are a great God. You see everything, you know everything. You never need any sleep. You have made this universe and you control it with your right hand. And yet we also read in your word, Lord, that you watch over us and your right hand, it covers us. That we as individuals are important to us, to you, each of us. And Lord, this morning as we open your word, we just pray that your Holy Spirit will direct us and guide us. And Lord, again, that all that we would say and do here would be to your Son's name, honor, and glory. Amen. Psalm 139, found on page 974 in your pew Bibles, if you'd like to follow along. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, or if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even in the darkness will not be darkness to you. The night will shine like the brightness of the day, for the darkness is as light to you. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame is not hidden from you. When I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me are written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you, God, would slay the wicked. Away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and abhor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them as mine enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of the everlasting. Amen. Today is Sanctity of Life Sunday, a day usually devoted to the protection of the unborn. But actually, it's not limited just to that. It also includes the supporting and respect and dignity of the elderly, the rights of the physically and mentally challenged. Most recently, it addresses bullying that goes on. In a nutshell, sanctity of life means that Jesus loves each person, and every life is important to him. And as he has taught us, we are to follow his example. But to understand that concept more clearly, we need to understand why God has such a special relationship with us. For without understanding God's relationship to us, we cannot understand what we should show to others around us. In the past, I've stressed that God made man differently than the animals. We are special, that he breathed into us the breath of life. As I was studying this week, one of the commentators made this point, I guess. And he says, if you imagine God breathing into Adam before he was alive, he breathed into his nostrils or into his mouth. That face-to-face relationship, it wasn't some whim or some accident. It was something that was ordained. It was something very special. And God intended to make it very clear that he wanted to have that special kind of relationship with mankind. He gave man a special job, and it wasn't to tend the garden. He told Adam and Eve to be fruitful and to multiply. But it goes deeper than that. In our text this morning, David's words speak very clearly. In verse 1, he says, God has searched us and he knows us. He's went online, so to speak. He's searched our Facebook page. He's went through all our text and everything, and he looks at us and he knows us, right? Wrong. He knows us from the beginning of time. He didn't have to go to Facebook. He doesn't have to look anything up. He knows it all. More than that, he puts effort into that relationship of searching for us and knowing us. If you look back into the Old Testament, when one of God's people failed him, when one of God's people sinned against him, God sought them out. He went after them, looking for them, trying to restore that relationship before it was too lost. Sometimes we don't want people to get to know us very well, do we? Oh, we may let a little bit out. We may share with them a little bit of our life, but there's some things in our life that are just too nasty, too dirty, too hidden. Sometimes we don't really want to get to know people very well, do we? We shun away from them, especially if they're different than us, or maybe they're quiet or withdrawn or private, and we don't make that effort. But God does. We often are afraid that people will find something out about us that we don't like or understand, but God knows it already. Matthew verse 10, verse 30 says that he even knows the number of hairs on our head. And some of us are making that a little bit easier for God each and every day. But despite knowing all of that, he also knows about all the skeletons, doesn't he? All those things that are in our life or that were in our life at one time. All those things that he could call us out on. All those things that he could make a huge, huge spectacle of. But he doesn't. Verses 2 through 5, David writes that God knows everything we are, everything that we're going through, everything about our life. He knows whether we're sitting down or rising up. He knows our deepest thoughts. He knows when we go to bed and when we get up in the morning. Every word that we speak, he knows before we even think about it. In these verses, David says that God hems us in. When you hear the word hem, what do you think of? Something sewing, right? You hem something up or whatever. And actually, that is a bad choice of the original wording that David uses. That word hem to the Jewish people described a city that was under attack, and how they would close the gates, how they would bunker down, how they would protect that city. God, in fact, is doing that for each of us, even right now. He's hemming us in. He's protecting us from those things that he knows we cannot handle.
But just as a city that is under attack needs somehow to get out of that situation because, well, if they can't get out of it, they're going to run out of food or water or something, and it's going to be devastation. God makes a way out through his Son, Jesus Christ. In verse 6, David admits something very personal. He says, God, I can't understand all that. It goes beyond what my mind can understand. No matter how much I study it, O Lord, no matter how much I meditate on it, it goes deeper than I can go. David declares that God is omnipresent, that he's everywhere, all the time. He sees and hears everything, that there is nothing hidden from God. And as I shared with the kids earlier, that fact of all those things, all those attributes of God can be very comforting to us when we're going through a tough time, but it also can make us quite uncomfortable, can it? Because there are things that we wish God just would not see. In verse 13, David changes gears a little bit and he talks about God and his creation. He talks about how God made us from the tip of our head to the bottom of our feet, how he knitted us together. God had a plan even before we were born for everyone and everything. How God can do that, I guess I'm with David. My mind cannot comprehend that. And if that isn't great enough, we come back to that point that God knows us personally. Each one of us. We are one of a kind. We are made uniquely. Each part of us fits together in a perfect way to make our body work. David goes further. He says that God watched all of this and he approved it. The human body is something very, very special, isn't it? When it's all working, it is a wonderful masterpiece of God's creation. But you put one little fly in the ointment and it can send our bodies in a tilt whirl. A spiral downhill so quickly that we don't even understand that it's happening. And each of us in our family or ourselves personally have been there. We go downhill so fast, but sometimes that climb back up, that recovery process, it takes forever. And sometimes it doesn't happen at all. And David says, while I don't understand this, you, O God, you do. God directs David in another direction. And in those closing verses, David talks about God's adversaries, his adversaries. And David is very blunt that he hates his enemies, that he would have God do them in. Besides, David says, the people that I hate are the people that you hate. Anybody have a problem with that? The people that I hate are the people that you hate? Does God hate anyone? He despises their sin. He hates that sin, but he loves each and every one of them. And then David, as if he has almost been given a little secret from God, maybe a little tap on the shoulder, say, hey, David, think about that a minute. David quickly asked for forgiveness. He asked for a change from God Almighty, that he would change his mindset, his way of thinking, to think as God does, to help him remember that God has created them too. So what does that mean for us today? The Reformed Church of Stout, January 22nd, 2023. Do we have a small sense of what we mean to God? How special we are in His sight? Do we understand that we bear His image? Can we grasp the love that He has for each of us? Can you do that? On a scale of 1 to 10, maybe a 0.5, right? In the vastness of what God is and how much He does care for us and knows us. That's amazing. Now take that times about 7.9 billion people that were in the world in 2021, so we're probably over 8 billion by now, but who's counting? And God has that relationship with each and every one of them. Each and every one of them. Whether they love Him or not, whether they've accepted His Son or not, God knows everything about everyone. God has searched each one of those 8 billion people out that He might reveal more of Himself to them. David says that when I awake in the morning, You are there. And as I read those words, I repeat those words, I think we all have that image of us waking up in bed, right? We wake up, whether by an alarm or whatever, and we get up, we're awake. But those words go much deeper. What David is really trying to say is we awake from our sinfulness and we understand what we have been doing wrong. We must remember, David says, that with God, there is no hide and seek. With God, there are no favorites. With God, this game of life, if you will, is not a game. It is something that is vastly and mightily important to God Almighty. He knows all of us by name. And that is why the sanctity of life is so important. Not because we think it is, not because we feel it is, but because to God it is. Period. Well, that's a pretty easy sermon, pretty easy to understand for the most part. We're important to God and we go out into the world, and what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Randy, your timing is unbelievable by the power of God, because last Sunday we started in our adult class a study on racism. And Randy asked each of us if we think we are racist. And we were supposed to answer at that point of time, yes or no, are we racist? And I didn't. I don't feel I'm racist. I try very hard not to treat anybody any differently than I would treat myself, no matter who they are, no matter what they look like. But last night, I went to the Waldorf basketball game, and they don't have enough parking for a junior high game, let alone a college game. And so you end up parking in a parking lot that has not had any snow removal, and there's 12 inches of snow that's been driven over, and there's ruts, and there's people getting stuck. And there's one spot way in the back. And I have my truck, so I drive there, and I park it there, and I'm thinking, boy, this is going to be a long walk. There are no lights in the parking lot. I met a person with different colored skin than I have. And I felt uncomfortable. I did. I felt uncomfortable. I, out of the corner of my eye, kept an eye on that individual. And then after they had passed, by the way, I didn't say anything to that individual. Okay, I kept my eye, you know, face down. A little while later, in the same parking lot, I met a young lady with the same color skin that I have. And she said, hi, how you doing? And I said, hi, how you doing? And I walked by and I felt totally at ease. Right? Why did I feel different towards the individual that had different colored skin than I did? Why was I at ease with a woman, a lady, a girl, who had the same color skin as I did? She had a big backpack or thing on her side, I don't know what they call them. She very well could have had a gun in there. But I thought nothing of it. David begged God to change the way he was thinking. And I must do the same. Now, I'm not saying that making sure that we're safe is unimportant, right? I'm not saying that we just go out helter-skelter. I'm not saying that. What I am saying that each person that I meet along the way, whether it's in a dark, snowy parking lot or whether it's in church on Sunday, they're God's child. They may not accept his son, Jesus Christ, but they still belong to God. May we each and every day remember that our game of life, our life's journey is not a game in God's sight. For he has made us all, and we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen. Our hymn of application this morning is number 516, Cleanse Me, O God. Amen. You may be seated. We have those that are listed in our bulletin that are struggling with cancer, and I'm sure there's many others that we know of in our lives. Tracy, any update on Tracy? Not really. Okay, still no insurance. So we're going to pray specifically that the insurance issue will be settled and that it will be taken care of. And so how's Alex's mom? Okay. 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 Up. Okay. So Alex's mom is struggling with keeping her white blood cell at the proper level. So we'll pray that that would be raised and that she could continue to have the treatments. Anything else of anyone else? Okay. All right. And what's his name? It's not, I don't remember. You know the amazing thing in light of what we've just talked about this morning? God knows his name. Yeah. Right? So we'll just pray for that great-grandson of your brother, and God will know who it is and take care of that, okay? All right. Anything else? If not, let's come before our Lord and let's pray. Father, I come before you with these fine folks here at the Reformed Church of Stout. Lord, I praise you that you know each of us and that we know you. And Lord, because of that relationship that we have with you, we also know your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, while his main purpose upon this earth was to save people from their sin, we also know that he was a servant, that he went out and that he helped take care of people. Lord, I thank you for the love of this church, for the caring that flows out of these folks, for those who are in need, for those who need a helping hand with their budget for buying food, for bringing food and other gifts to people who may be sick and cannot cook for themselves, for remembering our children and our grandchildren who are at college and who are struggling to make ends meet, and for so many other ways in which they help. Lord, I pray that you would continue to move us to be your hands and feet. Lord, I also pray that we would follow your example and that we would pray to you, Father God, often. That we would come before you for no reason, maybe just to give you praise and glory, or to fall on our knees in tears when there is someone we know that is hurting and need healing. Lord, we pray for this young child that is struggling. Lord, we don't know why you would have that happen in such a young person, but Lord, we know that you are watching over them and their family. Lord, I would pray that you would be with every one of them, even now. Lord, I pray for Tracy. I pray for healing, Lord. I pray that the treatments would be effective. I would pray, Lord, that there would be a solution with the insurance situation. I humbly pray that even now. I pray that you would be with Alex's mom. I would pray that you would help her white cell count to be at the proper level, that she would be able to continue with her treatments. Lord, I pray for Leanne and Al. Lord, I just pray that you would be with them. I pray that you would be with Noreen and Daryl and their family as they go down this road and possibly a new treatment, the unknowns. Lord, may you be very close to them. May you be very close to everyone who is struggling with cancer. May you even right now make it very clear to them that you care about them and that we care as well. Lord, I pray for Gwen as she has further testing and her heart catheterization. I pray, Lord, that you would continue to help her heal from the cold that she's had this week. I would pray, Lord, for others that need you in a special way that have been sick. Lord, I thank you as I look up in the balcony and I see Anna this morning. Lord, a miracle indeed that you have worked in her life. We praise you for that, and we continue to pray for her, that her life, Lord, would be as normal as possible. I think of the Kruger family and others, Lord, that have lost loved ones. May you be very close to them. Lord, may you find in your grace and your compassion that extra dose of love for them. Father, we just thank you for putting us here in Stout, Iowa, USA. Lord, we are so richly blessed here. We have so much more than we need and so far much more than many others. Lord, we thank you for the degree of safety that you give us in this area. Lord, I would pray that you would continue to bless this community. The churches, Lord, as they serve you, may your word ring out loud and clear. I would pray for Governor Reynolds and others, Lord, in our state legislators, that as they are meeting, I would pray, Lord, that they would do what is best for the people and that it would be your will when they vote and decide things for us. I pray for our national government and our leaders as well, for President Biden and his cabinet, for our Congress, for our senators, Lord, I pray for them. I would pray, Lord, that you would have us all pray for them often. Not in spite, but sincerely pray for them that, Lord, they too may do what is right in your eyes and what is best for the people of this great nation. I thank you, Lord, again for our military, for those that have served in the past to win freedom, for those that serve even now to protect us. May you be with each and every one of them as they are away from their families and bless them. Lord, I thank you that we can bring all these things to you. I praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the deacons bring forth our tithes and offerings this morning, let's stand for our doxology and offertory prayer. Father, we bring our gifts before you. We thank you. We praise you for blessing us. We pray, too, that you will bless these gifts and use them for the furtherance of your kingdom. Lord, for the hands that will distribute it, I pray that you will give them wisdom. And Lord, as always, we thank you especially for our salvation in your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of going forth is number 256, Because He Lives.
Thank you.
As I spoke this morning, I spoke of what God is doing for us right now upon this earth. But he's doing even more wondrous things for us. He's planning for us a day that we will meet each other in glory. And that's why I picked number 283. It also happened to be my dad's favorite hymn, What a Day That Will Be.